following is an interview with Mr. Jack Weinberger at his home in Oak Park, Michigan, on the afternoon of February the 6th, 1983. Donna Miller is the interviewer. Could you tell me your name and when and where you were born?
Well, my name is Jack Weinberger. I was born in a little town called Volové. It's in Czechoslovakia in the Carpathian Mountains.
Okay, and what date were you born?
Was September 6th, 1929.
Okay. Can you just describe for me your life before the war?
Like, what can I describe? Like a child over here would have to, you know, just like any other home. We were going to school and we were not rich, but we were small town people, mm-hmm. working people. We had a little land, we had a house. We were six children in the family, all boys. And so until 1944, until the big dark age came, I would say, and the Germans came in.
What did your father do for a living?
Oh, for a living, we had a small store, mm-hmm. Like a, here you would call it a grocery store. Mm-hmm. And he was also teaching on the side. He was like a Hebrew teacher, mm-hmm. with small children.
Did you have any other family living in your town? Any other relatives living in your town?
Well, my grandmother, my aunts, mm-hmm. we're all a big family. Mm-hmm. See, my original mother, my first mother, she died. She died in 1939. I was only 10 years old, she died. And my mother was at that time, Czechoslovakia was occupied, half by the Germans, half by the Hungarians. We were on the Hungarian side. When the Hungarians came in, the first thing they did, they took mostly young, able Jewish people. Instead of taking them to the army, they took them, they gave them uniform, just like the soldiers, but instead of giving them a rifle, they used to give them a shovel. They used to call them munkotabor in Hungarian. So, I remember very good. My father had to remarry again because we were small children. I was the oldest. And then he had another boy from his second wife. That was in 1940. Till 1944, until they took us away from all the whole family. My father was in and out from the service quite often. They took him in and out and let him out. He came in because he had a big family to support. Mm-hmm. Then 1944, the Germans came in. They took over Hungary, all Hungary, the Germans. Then they took us right away in the ghetto. We were in the ghetto 5 weeks, about 4 or 5 weeks.
Where was the
ghetto? Almost, I would say about 70 kilometers away from my hometown, maybe 40, 45 miles. Mm-hmm. They took from all the surrounding villages, everybody together. And I remember that it was 2 or 3 days after Pesach in 1944. We were there about 3 or 4 weeks. And then, the Germans, one day morning, they surrounded the whole ghetto and they took us, they put us on the trains and that's it. They took us to Auschwitz. Mm-hmm.
What was the name of the town that the ghetto was in? Sokirnitsa
in Hungary.
What were the living conditions like there in the ghetto?
Oh, very bad, very bad. We were, mostly the non-Jewish people were voluntarily, I don't know if it was voluntarily or what, they left the houses, and they were put in that, I don't know how many houses, it was a very small village, they were put in mostly from all the surrounding villages, from all around it, all the Jewish people, and they put them in. There must have been at least 10 or 12 families in one house. I remember the man, grown up man, and I was the oldest from the family, we were not sleeping in the house, we were sleeping, there were the cows. Like where they have stacks of high hay because we had no room to sleep. The woman and the children were sleeping on the floor, it was no bed. We were sleeping on the stacks of hay outside. And very bad, we had no food, no nothing, no hope, no nothing.
Was there, what about the food?
They had one kitchen set up, one meal a day. There was only, the kitchen was only set up about 2 weeks after they took us in that camp. And there was staying in line from the morning till, can you imagine, the whole, I have no idea how many people were in the ghetto. They always kept on bringing in new people from there. And there was only soup, and that's it.
Before the Germans came in, what was life like in the town? You went to school, to public school?
Yeah.
Was it a Czechoslovakian school or Hungarian?
Well, that was Czechoslovakian.
Czechoslovakian. Yeah. Okay. And then at home, did you speak Hungarian or?
No. Well, I said Yiddish in the family house.
And then did you go to Hader?
Hader, yes. Well, we had a big responsibility, even the kids over there. So early in the morning, we had to get up 5 o'clock in the morning and go out till 7 in the Hebrew school. Then go home and eat, and then go back by 8 o'clock in the morning to public school till 1 o'clock. And then they gave us homework in school too. We had to finish the homework, and then we had to go back to Hebrew school afternoon till nighttime.
How many Jewish families were in your town, about, would you guess? What percentage of the whole town?
Well, I would say, around 10,000 people, the whole mm-hmm. town. It was, compared here in the United States, it's a small town, mm-hmm. but over there it was considered a good-sized town. Well, we had, 100 talisim. I don't know what talisim, if you know what talisim means. 100 married families, Jewish families. So every family had a different amount of children, you know.
Do you have any idea how many of those families survived the war? How many people?
Very, I can count them on the fingers. Mm-hmm. I know one is in from. You mean from my hometown? Well,
was your family an observant family? Would you say?
What do you mean by observing?
Religious life?
Oh, yes, 100%. We were all, 99% in the whole small communities in Europe, mostly we were all religious. Mm-hmm. My father had a beard. He was really, really, they wouldn't even touch, if you give him $1 million of money or something like that on a Shabbos and a Saturday. Mm-hmm. Strictly, no smoking, nothing. Strictly kosher, everything.
Do you remember Friday nights at
home? Oh, yes. I have never, that was the most beautiful thing in the world, nothing else more beautiful than that. I mean, one thing here, they have a get-together in the United States when they have Mother's Day or Father's Day, the whole family sometimes get together. But in Europe, we had every Friday night, we had a get-together. There were candles and burning on the table. And the singing at the table, you know, even we were not rich, you know, but still, a little bit, just to see it. It's not like over here, you put everything on the table and everybody helps themselves, because over there we didn't have everything to help ourselves. Mother had to give everybody in the plate, wherever, you know, everybody should get the same amount. Karaki, come here! Okay. It was beautiful, most beautiful thing. It's hard to describe it, you can't even.
In the area that you lived in, was it a mainly Jewish area, or were there many Christian families?
Oh, there was no such a thing like over here. We had this mixed. It was no matter. We had no problems with the neighbors. Or, as a matter of fact, in our house, a house like this. This is, of course, it's a one-family house here, but in Europe, this was considered as a big house. We had a Czechoslovakian policeman was living in our house. And they were Catholics, and they knew just, and they had two children, a boy and a girl, two children. They spoke Jewish fluently. I mean fluently, just like, and they knew every Jewish holiday. They used to eat in our house. I mean, that's the only thing they were playing, is with Jewish kids. It was never any problems. When they took us away, when the first day they took us together, you see, when the Hungarians took over, when they turned in, First thing they did, they poisoned him. He was, because he was a Czechoslovakian policeman, so. But she got it on record that he committed suicide, which he was not, but she couldn't do nothing about it. So they gave her a pension, because her husband was a policeman, so she had to keep him out of shot, not to make any noise. When they took us away in the synagogue, women and children, the whole, everybody. And the synagogue was surrounded, and she was the only one, a non-Jewish person from the whole city. That day, she had permission, she came in to see us, and brought us in bread. She was crying like a baby. And I even can go further. My mother's jewelry, my father's jewelry, my grandmother's jewelry, whatever they have, just like in every house, they have some kind of jewelry, like you have a ring or a golden watch or something like that. The day they took us over, my father took it into her. She said, if I ever survive, or somebody survives, in case you don't survive, it's yours. And when I came home after the war, first thing I went to her, I mean, I never asked, I didn't even know about it. She gave it to me. I slept in her house. And as a matter of fact, last year I was planning to go. I don't know if she's still alive now or not. But last year, but then they moved to Czechoslovakia. Last year I was planning to go look him up. My wife talked me out. I was going to go to Poland too to see to Auschwitz. I wanted to take my children to see there and take some pictures. My wife, because there's a little problem in Poland now, so my wife wouldn't let me go.
When the Hungarians came in, did life for the Jews change then?
Oh, yeah, automatically. See, my father, he spoke very good Hungarian. And there were a few Jews who did speak Hungarian. Because, you know, Czechoslovakia is not very big. Here, the United States is bigger than the whole continent of Europe. So when I came in, the first thing we had slogans, Jews, 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 Jews. Of course, it wasn't that bad, but still, just to be called that name, it's bad. Just like somebody would be called a dirty nigger, you know, it's bad. Just like in the South, yeah, you have no protection. And as it went on, then they start building military installations around the city. And when the soldiers were marching down the street, they were singing anti-Jewish slogans at Real Laram, everything against the Jews.
Did that frighten the Jewish people?
Sure we did. Yes. But we did have a few friends too, just like I say, it was across the street, also a Jewish family, and they had somebody living in their house. He was a Hungarian policeman. He was very nice too. And he always gave us information, what's happening. He always gave us information, they adopted a new policy against the Jews. A Jew could own so much land. A Jew could own a store. And if somebody lives in a Jewish house, he doesn't have to pay so much rent, just half of it. He always knew ahead of time what's going to be adopted. So he always let us know ahead of time. But till the end, it was the worst.
Did your father get to keep his store, or was his...
No, they took it away. The store was taken away.
Were your parents at all active politically?
No.
What about Zionist groups?
Well, in my hometown, there were a few Zionists. They were truthful outcasts, which is really actually by our own people. Mm-hmm. See, we were so religious. The religious people don't believe in Zionism. They believe that a Messiah will come on a white horse, and mm-hmm. he'll lead us. So actually, but there were a few people who ran away to those days, it was called Palestine. Mm-hmm. They survived, but mostly.
Do you recall hearing your parents talk at all about what was going on? Did they ever talk about leaving or about?
Yeah, there was no place to leave, leaving where?
Yeah.
No place to leave.
You mentioned that you were all in a synagogue. How long were you there?
Only 2 days. Until everybody was picked up, you know, was nobody left outside. Everybody was picked up. I didn't wonder. Then we were all in one place in the synagogue. Then the trucks came in, military trucks. It was still Hungarians until the ghetto. In the ghetto, the Germans took over. But the Hungarians watched us, but the Germans were completely in charge, the Germans.
What was the name of the ghetto, the town?
Sekulenice. Yeah, Sekulenice.
And you stayed there 4 or 5 weeks and then you were taken?
We were taken, we were walking. They put us on, we had a little belongings, whatever we had, let's say, clothing or something like that. And the old people and the old women and children, they were put on horses, like. And the stronger ones, they had to walk behind, and we were walking, maybe it took us 2 hours to walk. I remember there was a little child. My mother was sitting with the child in the back of the wagon. And as the other horse was going, you know, a lot of horses just bit off a finger from a child. You know, and the mother started crying, and the baby started crying, you know. And stop, you know. And our German ran up, he said, it won't be long, you won't need it. So he gave us like a hint, just keep on moving. And that's all, I never saw that woman again, I saw a child again. And then they took us already near the station. And then the Germans going on the roof up, had machine gun set up. We were in the field first, all were constantly in the field. And on top of the roofs, from the buildings around, there were the Germans and the machine gun set up. We were ready to start praying, everybody praying to God that we thought this was the end or whatever. But it wasn't, apparently, because then they told us everybody, his family should stick together because they're going to take us to a resettlement center. Put us in the train, the cattle train closed up. Took, I don't know, about 4 or 5 days, I have no idea. No food, no nothing. Women and children, can you imagine? It went dark. Everybody had to go in the toilet there, everything was smelling. One woman even had a baby there. No doctor, no nothing. Just really just like you put animals in a cage, nothing. And I was 59 years old. I didn't even, nothing. It comes a time when even a human being is worse than an animal.
Were you with your family then still?
Yeah.
How many people about were in a train car? Do you have any idea? Crowded?
Crowded. Completely crowded, just like put sardines in a can. No place to move, you couldn't stand or nothing. The only thing like the cattle crane, one side had a little opening. Mm-hmm. Even if somebody wanted to jump or go out, you couldn't because it was so small. It was smaller than the screen of the television.
This
is
what, in May of 1944?
44, that's after they picked us up from the ghetto. They was already on the way to Auschwitz. We didn't know where we had been taken, we didn't know nothing.
Did anyone die on the train?
Not in my compartment. Not in my. But I did see when we arrived to Auschwitz and took everybody off. They pulled off a lot of people. They had already Red Cross ambulances waiting. Can you imagine how they were so camouflaged, like. Never saw there was.
What happened when you got to Auschwitz?
Well, first of all, when I got to Auschwitz, I remember when the train came to a stop, must have lasted maybe 15 or 20 minutes. All of a sudden, the train got split in half. Half, but, well, how would I describe it? Well, the train got split in half. Half of it was on this side. See, the whole train was there. Then the train came around, the other half came over here. Mm-hmm. The doors were opened up here, this side. The doors opened up here. Here they had like a sidewalk. Mm-hmm. We all came out from both sides. We came out walking this way. We came to a stop here. Here was in a German uniform, an officer. He had a big stick. He was leaning on the stick like this. You know, he was a big picture. And he had dogs around him. And he was just pointing with one finger, like this, right or left. We didn't know nothing about it. Apparently the woman and the children and the small children went to the right. And this was that. I and my father were sticking together. And the children, we were all boys, but the younger boys, he pointed to that way. I was a little bigger. He pointed this way. We didn't know nothing about what was happening. And it was the last time we saw her.
How long were you in Auschwitz?
That's just a week, maybe. Not long. We were there, we were just there for a week, then they took us away to Germany in Wolfsburg.
Did anyone have any idea? Did your father have any idea in Auschwitz what was happening or what?
Well, we did know. I mean, we did not from ourselves, but we didn't believe it. They were the old timers who were actually working there. They were all also Häftlinge, how you call them, people. Yeah, they were telling us, you see the chimneys over there, and you feel the smell. Those are your families being burned there. But so if you tell somebody like that, it's, you don't believe it. You didn't know it. Because at the same time, you were, every barrack was with barbed wire. The same thing, like across the street, you see another house with barbed wire. We did see people, women and children, gypsies. They were playing music. Here, you see gypsies. Why would they're alive? Why would they burn our family? You see, this is something, you couldn't believe it. We didn't know nothing.
Did you stay in a barracks there?
Yeah. But, you know, just like an army barrack, like a barrack. You stayed a week, maybe in Auschwitz. You were put in by, maybe, I don't know, at least 5,000 people in one barrack. I think three or four high, maybe six or eight in one layer. So crowded. And you go, can you imagine, take people from a home here yesterday, we had family together here, just...
After you were in Auschwitz for the week, you were taken then to Germany, is
that? Yeah, then we were taken to Germany, which compared, if I have to compare it to the second camp I was, it was very, very good. Mm-hmm. At least in the first camp in Wolfsburg, I was there until January 1945. At least they gave us, in the morning there we received one coffee, just coffee, mm-hmm. Black coffee. And then at night they gave us one soup, which was thick soup. That potatoes, no, just like that, potatoes, no peels, no nothing. Everything just cut a piece like that. Was at one time I used to work in the, I used to call it Kartoffelschalerei, where they cut potatoes. We had a machine cutting potatoes. It was for a German soldier that were watching us. They had to be peeled and cleaned. Same peelings, just like they peel them off, with the dirt and everything, but put in for us. This is a fact of life. And then we had to take whole kartoffel, that means whole potatoes, just cut them in pieces, no washing or nothing. But at night there was, if I had four potatoes, in Dorg I had three potatoes, that means I was a luckier guy because I had one extra potato. And so that kept us going until January 1945, when the Russians approached. The Russian front already was already, I don't know, 10 or 15 miles, we even heard at night the shooting going on. A lot of people did die in the camp. I never see anybody being killed. Nobody was killed in the camp. A lot of beating was going on. A lot of them. But nobody was hanged in that camp. Nobody was shot. There were a few incidents, they were beaten to death. But not...
Was that a work camp?
Work camp, yeah. They took us to work every day. Every day we got up. Every day we had to stay up. That means we counted. Everybody had it. We didn't keep it every day the same job. We always changed it on. For a while I worked in a kartoffel shop, cutting potatoes, which I was a very lucky guy. First of all, I had a little extra potatoes I could smuggle out to my father, which was a big help. My father died in that camp. It was in January 1945, from starvation. And the times were so bad, they had no, they couldn't bring in no food, the Germans, at all. the potatoes because they had to take the trucks away on the front. So they had to take us away. Then went to Austria. We walked for 2 weeks. It was in a big snow, very cold, 2 weeks we were walking. Till they took us to a train station, and I didn't know where it was. Mm-hmm. Then they took us to Ebensee, and over there what the real problem was, from January 1945 till May, around 4 months, there was just like, there was hell. There was really hell. Over there you could see, any place you turned around, you could see dead people just like nothing. And every day they kept on bringing in new people from different camps. And the younger a person was, he had a better chance of surviving. I mean, the reason, I don't know why, it's not, maybe he understood a lot less. An older man understood a little bit more and went in his mind, his head, and it was really bad.
Do you remember how you felt then? What you were thinking?
Oh, at one time, what I felt, I have a cousin in Cleveland, for an example. He's a few months older than I am. We were always together. I had another cousin, we were all three together. Mm-hmm. But in the first camp yet, when they came in, the German officer, that was Eichmann. I saw him in person, he was there in Eichmann. And he came in with the Hungarian son-in-law, he was Jewish. The Hungarian president Horthy, his son-in-law, was Jewish. But he was the president of Hungary, they didn't put him in a concentration camp. So they came in, he wanted to prove that Jewish people live nice. You know, in the camps, that camp was like a sample compared to other camps. So they made a selection to pick out the sick people. People got hurt on job, people get sick on job. Or the really young ones. So I was picked too among the young ones. They said they were going to send us in a working school. And my cousin, two cousins there. He was a little bit smaller built. They picked him out too. But being the Lager Elster, he knew my father. He said, you have a father here too. You have a father together. Father, mother, you're not going to be separated. You're going to stay together. So he took me out from there. He said, you're going to stay with your father. They were taken away right away to the gas chamber because they were not able to go right away. That's the only time I remember. And going back to the second camp, in there was already Ebensee. People, it was just like you go to an ocean, you see dead fish, hundreds of them, every day. And one day, after the war, when I was liberated, I only weighed 44 American pounds. 44 pounds, that's 22 kilograms. I was liberated by Americans. So Red Cross came in. Even General Eisenhower that time came in to look around. Of course, I didn't know who General Eisenhower is that time. An American female, how do you come from the vets, female nurses, or Red Cross. We had no clothes on, just like a dog has no clothes, nothing. No clothes at all, naked. We were not ashamed, we were not bashed, nothing, we didn't even think about it. That you have to, we thought this is the best to be living, you know. Nothing, I couldn't even walk. I had to crawl on my feet and crying. And then the Americans came and they picked out the really weak ones. I was among them, they took us on a sanitarium. So I was there about 2 weeks and they gave us food and started gaining weight a little bit. After the war, even after the war, a lot of people died. They ate too much from overeating because their stomach was so weak.
Going back to that first work camp that you were in with your father, were you in the same barracks with him?
Oh yeah, most of it, yeah. All, yeah.
Did he work?
Oh yes, everybody worked. It wasn't such a thing if he worked. Okay. Everybody worked. If somebody didn't work, it wasn't such a thing. If he didn't work, they...
Was he working with you?
Not most of the time, because it wasn't up to me or to my father. You see, he had not...
Where was he working?
Oh, it was outside. Over there they were building a lot of tunnels. They were building, like in the second camp, they had tunnels in the mountains. They were building factories there, in the tunnels, underground.
What was the name of the second camp?
Ebensee.
Okay. Was that, the tunnels were to put factories to have?
Oh yeah, inside, in the tunnels, in the mountains. They were inside, if you walked in those tunnels, it was just like a city. And it was all built by slave labor. there are trains going in. I mean, streets over there inside, just like, everything like underground. They're like building factories there, you know.
And you went there in January 1945?
In Ebensee, yeah.
And you walked, you said?
Oh, but not until the camp. No, see, we walked from the first camp. We had no transportation. They had no vehicle transportation. So we walked, you know, till they had to find a place to put us on a train. Then they put us on a train. There was already, and then when they took us to Ebensee, there was open trains. I remember one day I saw the must have been Americans, I guess, planes came down, and we were outside the city, in the German city. They were bombing the city. We saw actually the bombs coming down. And we were outside.
What were living conditions like in Ebensee?
This is if I would see my own thing, what I went through on television, I myself would say it's impossible, it's not true. You see, a lot of people even today say it's not true, people who didn't go through it. I don't blame them for not believing it, because I myself say it's not true. I believe it could not happen, but it did happen. It did happen. Like they showed the movie Holocaust, I was watching the movie too. Actually, they didn't show nothing in the Holocaust. They only showed a story from one family, from two families. But actually, the pain and suffering the people had to go through, you cannot believe it. Nothing. I mean, it's easy to say, I figure 6 million. 6 million is a lot of people to be...
Were there any civilian supervisors in the camps at all? Any, like the tote or any...
A what?
Tote.
What do you mean?
Organization tote. Any
yeah.
Civilian...
No, you mean the camp?
Yeah, in the camp.
The camp's strictly the Germans. Well, I don't know what it was. All of us is military. We had, I don't know what organization tote means. They had the red band, OT. But what it stands for, I never, I didn't know. But I imagine it was soldiers too or something, or civilians, I have no idea. But we have...
Did any of the prisoners wear different patches, different colors?
Oh yeah, you had Polish, the Jews had Judah, G. Over there, oh yes, we could, everyone could be extinct who is who. There are a lot of people in Ebensee, they hanged every, when we came out from work, coming back from work. There was every day a new surprise. One day 4 people were hanging, one day 10 people, sometimes 20 people just hanging on the, they had a big, a Pelplatz square where they had to get together. And every day at the same time, from different places where they came in from work, the music was playing at the gate. They were coming in, marching like soldiers. We had to stop over there and watching and keep our heads up. And just looking how people are hanging there, just like nothing. We didn't even, nothing. Just daily life, nothing. I remember maybe a month before the war, my cousin Clement and I, they took us, picked us up, you know, they took us to a place called Welz. It's also in Austria. The Americans came in and they bombed, there was a big railroad station there, and they bombed it completely, destroyed it completely. The trains couldn't go through at all. So they came into the camp, the Germans just picked out people to go to work. And I was among them, and my cousin was among them. And there were also German prisoners there too, I must remind you. Germans too, who didn't agree with Hitler's policy. And they were too. So they, being they were German, they knew the terrain. So we were working only at night. They escaped from there. Because they didn't have enough German soldiers to guard us, you know, so they escaped. They were picked up next day, they were brought back to Hindu. No questions asked. No trial, no nothing. Just picked up and said.
Was there much resistance?
No, couldn't resist with what? We didn't have nothing. No knife, no tool, no gun, no nothing. Nothing, we had nothing. Nothing whatsoever.
You stayed with your cousin in Ebensee?
Yeah. He lost his father. Father, too.
What was the food like in Ebensee? Was there less food there?
Less food, a lot less food. Less food. Can you imagine? I was only 44 American pounds. Now, how much food can I get? I was lucky every second day. Every second day. I remember when I came back already from Wales. We were there maybe a month, I don't know. Finally, because the Americans came back and they bombed it again. So apparently the Germans gave up to building it, rebuilding it. I don't know whatever the reason was. So anyhow, they took us back to Ebensee, which was the concentration camp over there. We could be guarded, no escape. See, here a lot of people were escaping. So when we came back to Germany, I was so weak, so weak. I mean, I couldn't walk, I couldn't talk. So one morning I got up and I couldn't even take off my shoes. I said to his name, my cousin Moshe, he said, Moshe, see my sheet of food, please. It's like you take a rubber ball, has a little hole, you press it in, you know, you can press it in, a little goes up. The same thing, I was dead all of a sudden that day, swollen from hunger. We used to eat outside, we were working outside in the mountains to build those factories. We were eating coals, you know what coal, plain coal, as you eat coals and grass and anything we could lay hand on just eating. And I said, no, said, this is my last time here. I have a pair of shoes, my shoes. It's the only thing I had. I said, no, said, it's my last day, my last time. I'm going to sign up for better off to die soon than later. They gave me the shoes. And they took us, it was called a hospital. And over there was ready, like a line to be dying. You know, just like slow death. And over there I saw already quite a few people from my hometown too, which I haven't seen him to a whole year. And I remember one name, his name was Bear, she said, Mishiankala, you know, Mishiankala, Mishiankala, we see. I said, no, who, don't you recognize me? I said, no, I don't even know who you are, which I didn't. Changed so much. At home he had a beard, he was religious. And here he got so skinny and weak, no beard. He said, I'm so-and-so. But then I recognized what it was. He said, Mishiankala, if you don't bring me a little, I know bread you don't have, you cannot give me, but if you don't bring me a little water, I'm going to die. And I'm ready to die. So I tried to go in the washroom to bring him a little water, just to wash plain water. By the time I came back here, it was late, it was dead. It was a little weak from hunger. There was, I would say, maybe 2 days before we were liberated. 2 or 3 days. You must have at least 20,000 dead bodies piled up. I mean, I'm telling you, not just speaking out, at least 20,000 dead bodies piled up, which they couldn't burn them. We had a crematorium, it was going 24 hours a day. The Americans and British were approaching. And we could smell it from laying outside, from the smell from the dead bodies. So they picked up a group of people to dig in the camp, ditches. Not to have proof for the they knew already the war, the Germans, they're losing the war. So not to have so many barbarians piled up, so they had to dig it, to bury him. Must have put 5,000 in a ditch. They're burying him there. Then when the Americans came in, they picked up the civilian people in the village, in the city. They came back and they had to take him out of public graves, take him out with cameras and pictures showing and take him out. I remember. Everybody had no clothes on, nothing. Civilian people came in and they used to hold their noses like that because it was smelling the perfect body. My God, it was right next to our villages, we didn't believe it. And they had to take caskets for every one of them, take them in the village to make a decent burial.
This was in Ebensee?
Ebensee. It was already after the war, I would say 2-3 days after the war, it was Americans made them do it.
Yeah. Do you recall any of the names of the factories that were operating there?
Outside. We never went.
Did you ever know any of them?
We never went in the city. The only place we went in is in the mountains, to those building those...
Were any of those civilian factories, though? Do you know?
Outside? I have no idea.
In the mountains?
No. What do I know about those things? We didn't know nothing. Everything belonged to the government, I suppose. I have no idea.
Were there capos in the camps?
Oh, capos were, oh yes, every camp had capos. The capos were actually inside people, you know.
Were they mainly German, or?
No. Inside, it could have been German, it could have been Jewish, but at least they had a better chance of survival. Because they had more food. And that's all. But everything was the main thing, it was just food, food.
Do you remember what you were thinking while all this was happening? I mean, did you?
Well, we were thinking, all the time thinking about a home. Mm-hmm. Thinking about Shabbos, family together, the mother, what is mother, how is she doing? And food all the time. Main thing was food and food and food. But we were not, it comes to a time where people are not afraid to die. We were not scared of that about death because death was around us every minute. Right now we saw him there, 5 minutes later it could have been me. I mean, maybe another 3-4 days, I had no food. How am I going to survive? It was not scary. I remember another person, he died in Ebensee. The same day when they were putting us in the trucks to take us in the sanatorium, the Americans. Yeah. People were, had ready little little things in their bags, ready, I'm ready to go home. When I came back from the sanatorium, they brought us back to Ebensee. Those people died after the war. Mm-hmm. They went in the village, they ate too much greasy food, you know, which we didn't have it. The stomach just couldn't take it. I remember one evening, it was Block 6 in Swansea, in Ebensee, Block 26. I don't know if you know, if you ever saw a military barrack here in the United States. Did you ever see a military barrack? Did you ever see it? Were you ever in a camp here?
Yeah.
Well, you know how a military barrack looks like?
Yeah.
It's exactly alike. Same thing. We were put in there, I would say, at least 500 people in one barrack. I mean, no beds, I'm not talking about beds. We were sitting one on each other, piling like this, sitting like this. The windows were taken off. It was in February 1945. It must have been the coldest winter in history. So cold. The windows were purposely taken off. No clothes on. Just people should die, you know what I mean? That's all we were put in. We had one man there, he was crying. His face was so swollen up from hunger, from starvation. Sometimes a person swells up. His eyes were covered up and swollen up. And there was a doctor there, which is, he was a doctor, in the hometown, you know. They were from the same city. He said, Dr. Fishbein, I know I'm going to die. Cut me up and do something, maybe I'll survive. Doctor, I never ran across this. I remember you saying, I never saw something like that in my life. I don't know why, I want to start. So he just took a sharp object, a needle or something. He just cut him here. And the water just started pouring out from him. I remember seeing that, those things. I remember he used to cut from the dead people, eat it like horses, like animals, biting off pieces of meat and eating. From human beings, like cannibals. Now they're a nation among nations.
Yeah.
So like today in the headlines in the Detroit News, first time in history it happened. They you see it in France? They're making a big headline out of it. He didn't make such a big fuss when that happened in Germany. He just picked up innocent children and women. He just killed them for no reason at all. For no reason at all.
When you were in Ebensee, was there ever any, did the guards ever use dogs?
Oh yeah, we had a lot of dogs. We had a lot of dogs. The dogs used to come in, really, see, I love dogs. But in those days, you see what dogs can do to, I love every animal. It doesn't have to be, like here outside, I feed the birds, I feed the squirrels, I feed the cats. Every day my wife fights me, how come I bring home meat? I work in a meat market, meat for the cats outside, every neighbor's cat. Used to come with the big dogs, you know, that Block 6 in Swansea, they were just coming in with the dogs and tear them apart. We couldn't do nothing. So we.
Did they train the dogs to do that, or did they just
know? Oh, he had the. Listen, You can train a, you can train a bear to dance. Listen, you can train a dog to do that too. He listens to his master.
Were there ever any German guards or people in the camps that helped at all, or that were at all
helped like what?
Compassionate or at all?
No. Inside in the camps, everything was done mostly 90%. The kapos inside. Of course, they were had to do it, or if not, it would have been done the same thing to them, strictly for self-survival. I'm not saying they did it because they loved to do it. Could have been, if I was older, I probably would have done the same thing. I'm not saying this for survival. There were many times, or even a son did it to his own father for self-survival. Not because he liked to do it, because he was a policy of the camp. The other 10%, the Germans just came in to supervise, to check if everything is going according to their plan, like with the dogs. They came in with the dogs. Dogs were not inside the camps. Dogs were strictly outside the camps. But they came in with the dogs. The dogs did their job. I remember from my hometown, he remembers him very good too, Martin Adler, because we are from the same hometown. There were two Jewish people and two non-Jewish people picked up. One was from my barrack, number 26. From my hometown, that he was, must have been at least 7 foot tall, very heavy. And there was another guy picked up from the next barrack, and there were two all picked up from another barrack in the middle of the night. See, because in that block section, where I was, there was strictly a dead row. People were dying every day. That man from my hometown, for self-survival, he pulled out a teeth from the dead people, golden teeth, just to sell it for a little bread. And when they were going outside, they were stealing it. When he took it outside to the Germans to be sold for a little piece of bread, they took down his hefting number. Everybody had a number, no name. They took it out, they turned him in. They came in one night, they picked him up, went from next door, there were four involved, four people. No questions asked, just looked up the number. Took them outside in front of the barracks at night, hung them. They were maybe 5 or 10 minutes hanging. They cut them down and took them out to burn them. Just like nothing, no questions asked, no trial or nothing. And this was going on every day, 24 hours a day. 24, the only thing a person didn't know when it's going to happen to you. So there was.
Was there any medical care at all there?
Nothing. Nothing whatsoever. Nothing. Nothing. It was strictly a death camp. Okay.
Any sanitary facilities at all? I mean, any bathroom facilities or any place to wash or anything like that?
Wash. You were taken out again. I mean, this is just hard to describe it. Here a person goes out to the car is parked in front of your house. You go out early in the morning if it's cold, you have to scrape everybody. You put on a coat and a jacket and gloves, you have to scrape up a little snow. In the meantime, you let the motor on to warm up the car. When you go in the car, you have a nice warm car. You're afraid it's a little cold here. But we were completely naked without clothes on. We were standing 24 hours a day in the snow without shoes on. Many dropped dead. Whoever survived had another day to live. I was there 3 or 4 days like that. How I survived and why I survived, I don't know. Maybe God was with me, or if there is a God. I don't know, maybe there's no God. Just luck, pure luck. It was going on. Meantime, there was people who had no luck. They just survived. They were using all kind of methods. All kind of methods. There are methods first from the beginning of the war to kill people, the Jewish people, by shooting them. They took them to the pits, they shot them and buried them. Then they came out with these gas trucks. I don't know if you heard about them. They were putting them in a truck, they marked a red cross, and they were gassed while they were on the way to the pit. Then they were using Auschwitz gas chambers. They were using another method to kill people by their own starvation. They were put in gas in camps by cold, by hunger, by thirst, by lice. There were times I could put in my hand to my arm like this and pull out a hand of lice. We used to eat them. Do you believe it? We were animals. Even a time after the war, these things happened. There's no Jewish people living in Poland now. There's no Jewish people. And they're being blamed for the trouble in Poland. Tell me, who's doing that? Look, even in Rome, what happened just a few weeks ago. They threw a grenade in a synagogue. Well, are we throwing grenades in a church? Show me one church we threw a grenade to kill people. In the entire Jewish history. In Rome or in Paris or here, do we ever throw the grenades or bombs? Or in Germany and Austria, they came in a synagogue, they killed for no reason at all. Do we do that? What would really happen, that guy who tried to kill the Pope a few last year, if supposedly if he was Jewish, what would have happened? Lucky he was not Jewish. I tell you, I don't feel sorry for the Pope, but I'm just saying, lucky he was not Jewish, what would happen?
Toward the end of the war, when you were in Ebensee, did the Germans stay until liberation, or did they?
They were smart. Those leaders, they knew everything was dismantled. They ran away. The SS, they had the Wehrmacht, the SS. Well, then the Wehrmacht, the oldest soldiers, must have been in the 50s or 55, which I consider them old because I was only 15. You know, anybody who's older than me, I consider them old. We saw already from inside the camp that they start cutting off their insignias, and their rifle was already carried upside down. They had no bayonet. We knew already they had already cut open from the wires, the lights were not burning, and we knew already that something is happening. But at the same time, they had a full barrack of bread, baked bread, ready to be passed out in the camps, who were still alive, you know, to poison the people. But I don't know what happened. The bread somehow wasn't passed out.
Was there a difference in the way the Wehrmacht treated people and the way the SS did?
Well, we never came in contact with the soldiers at all. The only contact we came is when there were killings going on, beatings, but talking, nothing. It was strictly forbidden for them. They had their orders, that's it. They were like in the first camp, for example, Wolfsburg, where I was in the first camp. If I have to compare it to the second camp, it's just like you take a person who's on the welfare here, or like Rockefeller, you know what I mean? Compare was really good, really good. I remember when we were marching to go to work, and he was an older soldier too, because mostly young soldiers, younger ones were in the front fighting, so the older ones, he was so weak, the soldier, he couldn't even carry his rifle. The rifle was heavier than him, just giving a soldier. He had a beard, and there was against the law to talk to him too, you know, he took an assault. But still he took his liberty, he said he's not afraid, he doesn't care. What are they going to do to him? They're going to kill him. He didn't care for the system anyhow. So he was so nice, really nice, when they brought us lunch, same thing they brought to the Germans too. But the German was a different kitchen for the German soldiers. He almost broke his bread in half. Gave me a little piece, and then he gave it to another youngster, the younger youngsters. So I remember him saying in German, he said, someday you are going to survive the war. You have a good future. So I will be the victim. Even though I don't approve of the system that goes on in Germany, I'm against it too. But still, what we are doing is very wrong. Now he used to buy newspapers, I remember, German newspapers. He used to pass it out to us, you should take it in the camp to read what goes on. He always had a little information. There were people, educated people in camp too. They knew how to read German. And they used to tell how many victories the Germans are making on the front and how many American planes they shot down. I always used to say, but they never mentioned how much losses they had. Then it was really after the war. Well, after the war, finally, when they took us from Ebensee, when Americans came in, they took us in a sanatorium, which I came already. I could walk already, and I was already strong enough. Then they took us back to Ebensee, and Ebensee, the Americans put us on truck, military trucks. Took maybe 48 hours, I didn't remember, the day and night. They took us to a city by the name Pilsen. It's in Czechoslovakia. And over there, they turned us over to the Red Cross, to the Czechoslovakian Red Cross. They gave us food. The Czech people were very nice to us, very nice. They were, you see, they brought in a lot of people day after day. They brought in from the different camps. And they came every day. They came out of the Czech woman with bread, baskets of bread. And we were so grateful, so happy. And they started giving us clothes and different things. Then they put us then finally we had already enough bread. You know, I figured I'm going to have something different. Or maybe a piece of candy or chocolate or like a hot soup. So another guy, I said to him, why don't we try to go from house to house and see maybe? Maybe one day, one place we knocked on the door was assigned Dr. So-and-so, was his home. And the lady up knocked the office, she said, oh, yes, I know who you are. Because we still had the German uniforms, you could tell we're not Czech. Come on in. She introduced us as the husband, the doctor. And there was a big picture of Stalin on the wall. I remember that. But I didn't know who the picture, I never knew who Stalin is or Roosevelt. I just knew he was president of. But to me, there was no difference who it is. I didn't care. She showed me the picture. Yeah, she told us, sit down. She did offer us candy and more milk. She said, you know who the picture is? I says, no, I don't know. I really didn't know. I know it's not Hitler, because if it was in the water, I would know it's Hitler. And it was still in prison on the American side. I says, oh, that's Joseph Stalin. Remember, you know, she asked us information, where we're from. I told her, yeah, we're from, you know, we're going home, Czechoslovakia, that's another part of Czechoslovakia, over there the Russians are. She said, don't forget, you have to be a good communist to. I mean, of course, I didn't care, to me, it didn't bother me. Then she took out, she gave me 50 Czech kronen, and she gave the other guy just like $50. I said, I don't need that. You know, I didn't care. I said, I don't need no money. What am I going to do with the money? To me, money is nothing. I just need bread. Just keep it, you're going to need it where you go. So very, the Czech people and Italian people really are nice, mm-hmm. people in general. Mm-hmm. When I came, then they put us on a train, we went to Prague, to Czechoslovakia. Right on the station, they had already set up kitchens waiting for us. They had already like plates. I took a plate, they gave us warm soup. And then we continued our journey to went home. Then when I went home, there was a place by the name Hust. It's around 60 kilometers, around 40 miles, just like from here to Toledo. There was no transportation to go home to my hometown because it was banned. Because I do remember when they took us in the ghettos, they built on the highways, and every highway they built holes, big holes, and put in dynamites there to bomb. And they did bomb it. Before they retreated, the Hungarians, they bombed everything. So one guy, he's in Israel now, and an older man. I call him older. At that time, he was 40 years old, so I call him old. So we had to walk home to my hometown. We started in the morning. Early in the morning. It was already in June, it was warm. We had to walk to my hometown, it took us a whole day. We took our shoes off, we wanted to spare the shoes, we didn't want to use up the shoes, so we had to walk with our shoes. We put our shoes on our back and we walked. So on the way we stopped a few places to ask, you know, we can get some to eat. We had no help from our own population. Didn't help us, not. Here the Czech people helped us, strange people. Here our own people did not help us. Finally I came to my hometown. First thing I did, I walked into that lady when I mentioned her husband was a policeman, a Czech policeman. She was very happy to see me. She cried, she asked me, where's your family? Where's the rest of the family? I told her, listen, the rest of the family, I think she was saying, which is the truth. She gave us to eat and she asked me, what is your future? What do you think I'm going to do? I said, the only future I'd like to know, I'm going to Israel. There's no future, I got nowhere to live here. She said, why don't you settle down here? I mean, she was very nice about it. She said, I have a nice daughter. Which she did have a beautiful daughter. She said, you can live here. She spoke a beautiful Jewish daughter too, because she was raised almost like Jewish. Or if not, you can marry her. And I didn't even think about marriage at that time. I didn't even think about myself. She said, oh, maybe you can meet somebody else, some Jewish girls. Anybody, where are you going to run her again? Settle down, you got a house here. I left everything. Because I stayed a few days in my hometown, and because I figured, like right across the street, was also like a big place. So from the church on Sunday morning, I remember the people when they came out from church, there's a get together. There are two churches in our place. Places had one Catholic, that's Pravoslav, the second one is Uniak. I don't know if you know what it is. Pravoslav, that's, I think it's, one is Catholic and one is, what is the other one?
Protestant,
I would say. So when after the church all came out, so they had a get together. As I was walking out from the house, from that lady, and I had a good pair of boots, and I had a German uniform, a German, military boots, and still had a uniform from like a German uniform after the war. She said, and I remember that as a lot. That gave me already the idea what to do. And they told me, you still survived? I'm surprised, they didn't kill you. But if you stick around long enough, I mean, they were looking at me, I just with my head down, if you stick around long enough, they were looking at my shoes and my clothes, if you stick around long enough and at night, if I meet you on the street, you're not gonna survive because your boots are worth to be killed. Just like that, our own people. So I mentioned that to the lady who was living. She said, you know something, those people didn't mean it. They're just even over here, I'm not gonna live here, they're animals. You gotta be very careful not to go out at night. But I didn't stay long, I only stayed 2-3 days, then I had to go back to Hust, used to call it Hust, I had to walk back. And from there we went to Hungary, Budapest, and from Budapest, started going our way to Israel. But we couldn't go to Israel, we had a hard problem to go to. By the way, do you smoke?
No.
Can I offer you a coffee? I should offer you a coffee. My wife put
that's
up.
Okay.
Stupid of me, dumb of me. My wife put up some. I have one, but if I have one, you have one too.
I have one, thank you.
My wife said, well, she put up coffee here. Like sugar and cream?
No, just plain.
No, just plain. Oh, no. Well. He and she are animals, not those. We are a lot worse than they are. Those animals will not do what human people can do. That is true. If I would see again, what happening, what's happening in Germany, I myself say it's not true. It did not happen. 50 years from now, I'm going to be 6 feet underground. I don't blame those people 50 years from now. They will say this never happened. Or 1,000 years from now. See, we do believe that Jesus Christ was killed. One person. One man. He was also Jewish. He was killed. The whole world knows about it. We believe in that. But what happened to millions of people, nobody will believe. See the difference? So therefore, many times, I don't know if I'm right, if I'm wrong, I'm not an educated man, I never had a chance to get education, I never had a chance to go to school,
like the American kids have, like my son has, or maybe you, if you have children, I don't know if you have children. Like now they're talking about disarmament, these big powers. The world deserves to be destroyed. I will say that. The Russians, the Americans, don't think the Americans are better. The Americans are SOBs just like the Russians, just like the Germans. Because we are, as long as we are building the bounds, we are just as guilty as the other guy who's threatening us. Because an animal, if he goes out, he's only looking to get food, nothing else. It doesn't bother nobody else. We are looking for something more.
Was your cousin with you the whole time? Was your cousin's friend?
Yes. See, my cousin in Cleveland, going back to my cousin, this is where I was, when they, oh, see, I cannot tell you the story. See, if I would be a writer, I could start. It would take years and years to recollect everything what happened. This is not just to tell in 5 minutes or 10 minutes. My cousin was with me all the time. Just like I mentioned before, I gave him the shoes. In 1945, May 1945, May 6th, when we were liberated, I was in the called Revere. Revere, that means like a hospital. The hospital was strictly for the in line to go to die. He was still he was among the healthy people. I was so weak. When he came, when the war liberated, he came to look, he knew where I was. I couldn't go to see him because I was weak, I couldn't walk. He came to look after me, he found me. And he was already, he was walking, talking, he was healthy. He said to me, Moshianto, I'm glad I'm seeing you, but I'm ready to go home. He was ready to go back to leave the camp. But I couldn't even think about a camp. I don't know, maybe I'm gonna live another day or two. But in the meantime, they sent me in a sanitarium to recuperate. When I came back from the camp, they brought us back to Ebensee, the Americans, to that camp. I thought he left already for home. But in the meantime, I saw somebody else, which, you know, people knew each other. They said, you know, your cousin Moshe is still here. He's very sick, he's ready to die. I said, it's impossible, because when I was ready to die, you know, he was healthy. He said, yes, he's ready to die because he went in the city. He overate. You know, we were so hungry. He overate. He couldn't take it. He became typhus. He was sick. Now he's in a really hospital. He's in an American hospital. I went to look him up. He couldn't talk. He was ready to die. But somehow he recuperated. Now he lives in Cleveland.
Did he go back home with you?
No, he didn't. He wanted to go home before me. But I went home before him because I left him there.
Did you go with friends or were you by yourself?
Oh, no, we were a lot of people. See, everybody was friends. Everybody had enemies, everybody had friends. You see, there was everything to see. We were just like I say, animals. There was no friends. Everybody for himself. No friends. Could know who was. Just a little piece of bread, whatever to survive.
How did the Americans treat you when you liberated?
Oh, they're nice. First of all, they set up kitchens right away. They made kitchens, you know, food. That was the most important. That's the only most important thing we have. Yeah. And we had every day coming in, every day different American journalists, you know, from the press, and taking pictures and taking interviews and different. But they were nice, so nice. But still, we were still the. It's not that ham, please. I don't know. Most of the time, if you get fat from this, I take the blame.
You mentioned something when you went back to your hometown. And you talk about the people who had met outside of church and who had said that to you about the boots. And yet before the war, you said there was no trouble with those people. What changed them? What happened to them?
Well, first of all, there's a good reason, a very good reason. Most of the people were killed, most of the Jewish people. Like in my hometown, we had a house. The house was about this size, maybe bigger. But compared over there, but that, the standard for Europe was a big house. In our house where we lived, in the rooms where we lived, you see, we had tenants too. But in the rooms we lived, somebody else occupied that place. They had a free house. They didn't have to pay rent, life insurance, nothing. Now all of a sudden these people started coming back. A lot of them came back. So they didn't like it. They would have a problem. They figured they would have to give it back. Some people, like my cousin in Cleveland, they owned horses. We didn't own the horses, but he owned horses. Before they took us away, he gave the horses to a non-Jewish person. He said, in case I survive and my children survive, when they come home here, maybe you can give us back the horses. When he came home, they wouldn't give him back the horses. I have another cousin who lives in New Jersey. He had chickens. You know, we had little like a farmhouse. We had chickens and eggs and ducks. They said they all died out when he came back. See, we couldn't find nothing out. So that was the whole thing.
When all the Jews were rounded up from your town and put in the ghetto, did any Christians ever try to help? Was
no.
there anybody who...
The only one who helped, the only one person in my hometown, is that lady who was out in it. That's the only one who came in at the synagogue that day. It was a big synagogue. Brought some food. The only one. Only one. What do you mean, help? They were cooperating mostly, I'm not saying all of them, but mostly were cooperating with the Hungarian soldiers. We should be taken away. Because we had one synagogue they used to call down. The big synagogue was, I would say, maybe half a mile from my house, from my father's house. Then we had a small synagogue, was right next door to my father's house, small. When the Hungarians came in, they took the synagogues over. Sometimes for a month, sometimes for 2 months, sometimes for 3 months, they put in horses there. Because soldiers are moving back and forth, up and down the front. They were going with horses and trucks too. They didn't have enough trucks. The horses had to sleep someplace. They took the soldiers, they put them in the Jewish houses, whether you like it or not. They came in, let's say, to Mr. So-and-so, I'm gonna bring you 4 soldiers tonight. They're gonna sleep here for 2-3 days. You gotta give them bed, places where to sleep. They didn't ask you if you have room or not. They didn't care if you sleep outside. If you said you don't have where to sleep, they just kicked you out from the house. They made sure that the horses had to sleep someplace too. The horses they put in the synagogue. And this is true, in the synagogue. They kept them there sometimes a week, sometimes two. When they moved away, they left us the cleanup to do. You know, the horses are making up. So when the horses were not occupied, when the synagogue was not occupied by horses, we had a right to use it. It was until they took us in the camp. One morning we got up, on a Saturday morning before we went to the synagogue, most of the Jewish houses and synagogues were marked with swastikas. And it was an Hungarian written, long live Salasi. See, in Hungary, just like in Germany, the leader was Hitler. In Hungary, the leader from the Nazi party, his name was Salasi. Not the president from Hungary, but from the Nazi, they had a Nazi party too. His name was Salasi. After the war, he was the Russians caught him and they hanged him in Budapest. His name is Salasi. So the president from the shul, from the synagogue, called, you know, like a man, not a Jewish person, he said, because Shabbos we didn't want to do something like that. He said, go, he took him in the house, and I got a little paint, and go paint off the swastika from the shul. And then their own local politician, they were watching, they came up, they said, call him over, they said, and they said, you know, you're going to pay with your life for that. That swastika is there for a purpose. They threatened him to. See, even so, just like a terrorist, you know, something threatens you, so you're afraid. Even there were maybe a few people that tried to help us. They were threatened, they were afraid.
Were your schools closed right away too?
What do you mean school?
The public schools. Were you allowed to go to public school after the...
No, not under... from the beginning, yes.
Yeah.
From the beginning, yeah. I don't know.
Now, after you left your hometown, after you were liberated, and then you went, you were going to go to Israel?
Yeah, I was trying to go to... Oh, that time it was called Palestine.
Right. So what happened? What happened after you left?
Well, I went to Budapest, you know, from Hurston to Budapest. Then they had other organizations. People who wanted to go to Israel. They were put on trains till the border, till the Austrian border. From the Austrian border, we had to go through at night. To go, you know, it was from the Russian side, you saw, because over there was the Russians. To go through at night, to go through the border, to go to the English side. And there we were a few weeks in camp too, but English wouldn't let us go no place. And then from Austria we went to Italy. I was in Italy for 2.5 years. We stayed there, we were waiting, and we were ready one day to go, and then again they canceled it. We couldn't go, the ship was caught, everything was illegal. But in the meantime, we figured, well, I'll take a chance, I'm registered to go to America, to Brazil, to Uruguay, Paraguay, Canada, wherever I come. Because there was no future, no hope in Italy. So this deal came up, which I never thought about coming over here. See, I served in the American Army here too. I was in Korea too.
Was it hard to get papers to come to America? Was there any trouble?
Well, actually, I didn't work on the papers, you see. I had nothing to do with coming here because I was under 21. See, I think Mrs. Roosevelt, I would say, helped a lot of the, you see, people who left, didn't have no family, lost their families. I think the Jewish organization helped us to come here. We were underage, we had no place to go. So I think the quota, we came outside the quota.
You said you were in Italy for 2.5 years?
2.5 years.
Did you work while you were there?
No.
Or did you?
We didn't work at all.
Uh-huh.
But, well, I worked in the camp a little bit, but you know, I'll tell you what my job was. You might be laughing, but it's not a joke, but it's true. The work was only done strictly to have a little pocket money. We were not paid. Some people had family in America, so they sent them a few dollars, so they had money. I had nobody to send money. Food we had for free. Half of it was from the UNRWA at that time, and half of it was the joint, Jewish joint. But in order to have a little money, so I volunteered to pick up the garbage. Like, here's strictly like garbage, man. Plain simple over there, you call up the sanitation garbage, whatever it is. But over there it was dirty garbage. Here it's clean garbage, here it's ready in bags, put up and tied up, and which is nice, but over there it wasn't like that. So they gave us a few pennies just to have a little extra pocket money, that's all. But otherwise working, no.
So you came to the United States then in what year?
1948. Rocky, come on, go ahead.
And did you come right to Michigan, or did you?
No, we came first to Cleveland, Ohio. We stayed, I don't remember how many months, not very long. We went there and like in a home.
Mm-hmm.
People who cannot afford it, people that are parents or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
They had a school over there too. And then from there, some kids were sent to Chicago, Boston, Los Angeles, Detroit. We wound up, Martin and I wound up in Detroit.
Mm-hmm.
We went to the office, I said, in case when the time comes for us to, we like to be together, not to be split up.
Mm-hmm.
So, because we were after the war, we were together too.
Mm-hmm. And where did you stay in Detroit?
Well, at first we used to stay in a house, in a family, I should say, on Linwood.
Did you go to school here?
Yeah, I went for a while to school.
And where did you become a citizen?
Oh yeah,
when was that?
1953.
Did you encounter any problems here in this country?
Well, from the beginning I did. I remember there was also when the Jewish organization helped me to get a job from the beginning. So I always told them I don't like to be independent. I don't want to be always on their welfare. It's mm-hmm. just like a welfare. So they always try to send me different places. I remember they always must have leads. So one place I came in, I remember that very well. It was my first bad experience in the United States. Oh, you must be German then, Mr. Weinberger. I says, no, I'm not German, but I was in Germany, but I'm Jewish. Oh, you're Jewish? As a rule, my company now doesn't hire no Jewish people. Here in the United States, my company doesn't hire no Jewish people at all. Our policy is, I'm sorry. That's all, that was my question. Again, this was very, very shocking to me, you know. I couldn't understand that, but then I got used to it. It's not the first time. We have the Ku Klux Klan here, have the Nazi party, and once in a while, even where I work on the job, you heard those kind of remarks. The Jews are responsible for the war in Vietnam, in Lebanon and everything. And that's it.
Who else from your family survived the war?
No, nobody. We were six brothers, all boys, no girls. We had one girl, but she died before they took us in camp. She was only 4 months old. But I was the oldest, and the rest of them all perished. My father died in January 1945, January or February, I don't know exactly the day. He was with me, we were all together, but my mother never saw.
When you first came here, did you ever talk about your experiences to anybody? Did anybody ever ask you questions?
Or? To talk to another guy who was in Europe in the war, it's just like everybody had some kind of different experience. Who was there knows it, just like if somebody's in the war, a soldier knows what a soldier's life is, isn't it? No, you cannot talk. What am I going to talk about?
Did American-born people, though, ever ask you questions?
Oh, yeah, they should ask me from the beginning, but if you don't see it, sometimes they say seeing is believing. If you don't see those things, sometimes it's hard to believe. Even if you see it, sometimes you don't believe it. Look.
Do you have any feelings about how the American Jewish community reacted during the war, just before? Do you think they could have done more?
Well, during the war, I don't know nothing about it.
Yeah.
Look, I was 15 years old. Take for example here, a 20-year-old, for example. What does he know what goes on in the world? I was 15. I didn't know nothing about it. I didn't know about Americans. I didn't know about the Jews. The one thing I remember, they were talking many times at the synagogue, the older people, our parents. It was before they took us away that they were looking forward that the Americans should open up the second front. Maybe if they open up the second front, maybe the war will come to a faster conclusion. But otherwise, we don't know nothing about it. After the war, I would say the Americans did show nice things. They helped us to go home, wherever we wanted to go. They did set up kitchens. That's all. But at the same time, the Americans gave a lot of protection to the Nazis after the war, like after the war. See, the Russians, for example, if something like this happened, they didn't give him a protection. They said, listen, if you committed a crime, you should pay for it. You should other guys suffer. You should suffer. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Which is it. Right? So, the Russians didn't play around. They suffered a lot with the Russians. Like in Ebensee, in Wolfsburg, in the first camp I was, we were only Jewish people. Only Jews. All kind of Jews. Italian Jewish, Greeks. From Germany, from Hungary, from Poland, all from different countries. But in Ebensee, we were already different nationalities, non-Jews too. We even had Germans there, really Germans, which maybe was a criminal, or maybe he was a politician, or maybe who knows something, didn't agree with the policy, or who knows. All kind of people, Polish and all. But from all the people, from all the nationalities, the lowest ones were the Jews. They were kept the lowest. The worst jobs, the least food, the most punishment he got, everything. The first victims were always.
Were you kept in separate barracks too?
No, we were mixed, all different barracks, to make any difference.
physical illnesses as a result of his parents?
Well, my two front teeth were knocked out. Condition that I have now. Mm-hmm. I had them made after, when I came to the States, I had them made, and then I had them made again.
Yeah, I was stabbed from a bayonet here. I don't know if you can start this.
It's a permanent mark, my German. And here, when they were stabbing me, I was hit with a butt from a rifle. They knocked two off my teeth. When they hit me here, with a butt, my teeth were knocked out, upper teeth.
Where did that happen?
Where was that? It was on the way when they were taking us from, we were walking to the train station from Wolfsburg.
Does it bother you to talk about what happened with people who didn't have the same experiences, people who weren't?
No, not at all. If a person's interested, mm-hmm. he wants to listen, he wants to know, mm-hmm. and what he had. I'm very happy to tell what happened. I'm not happy to what happened. I'm just happy to tell what happened. But if somebody wants just to kill time, just, you know, to know, you know, he forgets about it tomorrow, it doesn't, you know.
Do your children know? Have you talked to them?
Well, they know what happened, but they know I was in camp. They know what happened to my family. I have to explain them many times, but they're American born again, just like anybody else. And to them, they got more important things to do than to them. It's more important than to my past, than what happened to me, you know.
Can you met your wife in this country?
No. See, when I came out of the army, I was in Korea here too. When I came back, see, I was always pro-Israel. Even I wanted to go to Israel before I came to the United States. That was my first choice. I couldn't go. They had a quota, and the Arabs and the English were there. So in the meantime, this came up first. So I figured, well, I go here first. Now I was followed up to what goes on. When I came out of the army, I made up my mind, well, listen, I'm going to take a trip to Israel. I have family there too, from my father's side, my father's sisters, and well, I'm going to go up. So I went to Israel. I figured I'd go up. I go there maybe for 2 months or maybe 2 weeks. I didn't set no time limit, but I stayed there by 8 or 9 months. I liked it. And, meantime, I stayed with my aunt. I didn't have to pay rent. I didn't have to pay food. Mm-hmm. So the only thing cost me is a ticket. So in the meantime, I met my wife and I got married. And that's it. Mm-hmm. If you meet my wife, it sort of happened she had to go away. Mm-hmm. See, my wife, actually, she was born in Germany. She was born in Germany. She was born in 1935. Now, when Hitler came to power, I think it was in 1933, if I'm not mistaken. My wife was born 2 years after Hitler came to power. The trouble in Germany started. They went to Belgium. So they lived in Belgium for a long time. Until the war ended, actually. Her father, my wife's father, that means my father-in-law, he worked in a coal mine. He had false papers that he's not Jewish. Her older brother, they found out he's Jewish. Was taken away and shot. My brother's here. My wife didn't even know she's Jewish. She was raised in a Catholic school, a Catholic nun school. But she always, until after the war, she was told who she is actually. As the war ended, she still was my wife all the time, after the war. Then she was told that, you know, her brother was shot because he was Jewish. And, wasn't told that. And then she said, oh, and then after the war, after still she went to school, the way she was called a few times to read Jew, you survived. They always, in school, they always thought that she's non-Jewish, but then she found she Jew. So then she said, well, she came to and she said, well, I want to go to Palestine. Palestine. She went to Palestine, to Israel. They settled down there, one child. Meantime, I came, I met her, and, you know, this is what proposed and we married. Her mother died. I brought her here, her mother. She lived here for 20 years in this house. She died here last March. Her father died just before he came. So her mother died, lived with us for 20 years until she died.
many children do you have?
I have two. My son just called from California. Took off 2 weeks ago. See, they live in a different mind, the generation today, than we lived in Europe. Of course, thanks God, I'm glad they have a different... They don't have to worry about so much. We always had fear what the next day will be. We always had food and clothing and all kinds of things. Today, as I lucky my son, he has a job one day, he works, he saves up a little money, goes, blows it, you know. Doesn't bother him.
Do you ever have nightmares about what happened?
I do have once in a while, and before I go to bed, every night, and this is 7 days a week, 7 days a week, I always think I've done my best. I will never forget it, and I can never forget. And I don't want to forget.
Are there ever things that you see here that happen here that bring back vividly anything that happened to you like in the camps?
If this can happen again? If this could happen again? Definitely could happen again. Could happen again very fast too. Maybe not to us, maybe not to the Jewish people. Next time the same thing can happen against Unus, against Chinese, against blacks. And I tell you, it could happen even worse. We don't even know. They have more modern technique. See, when the Germans came out with these gas chambers, crematoriums, those were new things, gas trucks. Those are already old now. Maybe they can work on a new thing where they can mass killings going on a lot faster. They can fly to the moon. They can have, come up with something new? This can happen. Those things happen all through history. Right now it happened, this time happened to us Jewish people. The same thing happened 500 years ago in Spain. It happened in Poland, it happened on the Tsar. This will never stop. Maybe it will stop against the Jews for a while, but it will start. Look what goes on in Cambodia, Vietnam, in different places. Everybody can. Look, even the massacres that goes on in Lebanon. The Lebanese are killing the Christians are killing the Muslims, and it's just another day. Even yesterday, 20 people got killed. That's just a little day.
Do you think if Israel had existed as a state before World War II, things would have been different?
Oh, 100%. No question about it. No question about it. There would not have been 6 million Jews killed. First of all, if Israel would have been a state, they could put up an army of 300,000 men. And they have a strong army. Even, of course, they're a small army to fight the Germans. Don't get me wrong. But standing next to the British, next to the French, against the Germans, Germany would say, we got a reason with them. They do have a strong army. After all, they can go into war and take our prisoners. They're going to do the same thing to our prisoners. You know, that was a different thing already. And not just that, they could have opened doors to let the people in. It's another thing. They could have saved another million Jews, or maybe 2 million Jews. What is it, you know, we had no place to go.
When your father died at the first camp you were you said that was a better camp in terms of food and things from the second camp.
Oh, compared to at least they didn't hang no people for one thing.
Yeah.
I never saw nobody being killed, like being shot. They did beat them once in a while, yet. Okay, but isolated cases. But to see every day hanging people, mm-hmm. I never saw it. Mm-hmm. Not in the Wolfsburg. At least we knew we're going out tomorrow in the morning to work. At night, at least we knew we have a bowl of soup.
Yeah.
Bowl of soup. And we were hoping the soup is going to be thick. Thicker it is, at least for the more.
Yeah.
And then they had a slice of bread. But at least then we had a place where the barracks were at least closed up. They had windows and they had a door. At least it wasn't that cold, wasn't it? Mm-hmm. We had lice, plenty of lice, no question about. But at least, you know, it was bad for those days. But then it got a lot even worse. A Ebensee was a declared extermination camp. Wolfsburg was Arbeitslager. Arbeitslager means a working camp. Yeah. That is a bit. At least we came in contact once in a while with the Italian prisoners, which they had other camps around Wolfsburg. They had more food, they gave us a little food once in a while. I remember one time, I walked into the German guard who was watching us. He sent me actually go in the house, maybe they can give you some food. And they had a Wehrmacht, they sent us in the house. So.
Yeah, when you told me that you were injured on the walk from the first camp to the train to the second, to Ebensee, how did that happen? What caused them to do that to you?
Do what?
When he stabbed you?
They were pushing us to catch up because many we couldn't walk. We were so weak. Many people were, and we had, look, they had some wagons had one horse, some had a wagon had two horses. We had to push the wagons in the back to help the horses because they had a lot of food supplies for the Germans put up there, you know, for them. And they had to be transported. They had no way of getting a transporter. Many people died. We just had to pick him up and throw him in the wagon and just leave him behind.
Did you get any kind of medical care when that happened?
No, nothing. Sometimes a person can be stronger than a lion and weaker than a fly. There were times, sometimes you hear, sometimes you get a little cut, you go to a doctor, he gives you 20 stitches. Sometimes you can be a big stab wound and that's it. If you're lucky, you survive. There was nothing to turn to, nothing.
Did any of the German citizens who lived in the towns nearby, did they have any contact with you at all?
No, never. I remember going back to that, I said, when Germans, I mean, we were working, there was no special assignment. There was always different assignments. They were building the highways, the tunnel, and the different things. Mm-hmm. You were working on the highways, building the highways. So it was that German soldier, he had a beard. He was a very nice man, really, really. Him, there were very few isolated mm-hmm. cases, very nice. And took me over, took a walk with me. He showed me go in the house, maybe get some coffee. So when I came in the house, can you imagine it? And he didn't know either that the soldier took me down. And this I remember. He said I was sitting on a Cessna, a young Cessna. He must have just come home on furlough from the front on leave, a young man. And he was with his girlfriend or something. And there was the housewife that gave me bread and I should eat. And then she made it a big container. Maybe a 5 gallon a container of coffee. I should take it out to the rest of the guys. And the inside assessment said, no, you will not do such a thing. That man who gave you permission to come here should be shot. You know, Germany said, of course there was a violation that he wasn't supposed to do. And the daughter, she must have been his girlfriend or something, and she started yelling at him in German. At that time I understood a little bit. You will not do such a thing, if not then everyone. When I see her again or something again, anyhow, nothing happened. He let me take the coffee to the rest of the guys. And we took it back. I remember one time when I had to work, as we were working in the fields, a big machine, from the train, fell over to a man. He just squashed him to the head, just like nothing. You saw them now when the machine fell over, it just squashed them just like nothing. Didn't. Nothing. No, nothing.
After the war, after you were liberated, did you then have any contact with the German people at all?
No. The only thing when I came back the second time to Austria, already from when I passed through already my hometown, when I had to reclose, I was on the way to go to Palestine. We still had to have survival, to have food. Main thing is just food, that's all. So many places we went in, they chased us out, they didn't want to get us nothing. But many places,
We had a little money they sold us. Many places we had to do our own. We had to go in the garden, the backyard, cut off, plain simple stealing. We had to cut off from beans or tomatoes or apples or whatever we could find. But not me, not. They were the super race. Truthfully, they were taught in their mind, the Germans. They are the super race. And we are subhuman. Just even you can like a dog, you have a dog in the house, still, you are the human. You have to live first like a human. You gotta have the best and everything, and you're still second class. Am I right? The same thing it was with them. Let's put it in their mind. See, my father, it was in 1943, or 1942, I cannot recollect exactly 1 year, when he was in Munkertal, in Hungarians. They were fighting on the side with the Germans against the Russians. Jewish people were not taken in the army at that time. But instead of, but they were taken in like Munkertal, used to call them. Only the men, the able men. They didn't take all families, just able men. They were giving German, not German, Hungarian uniform, just like the soldiers. Same uniform, but instead of a rifle, they were giving a shovel. Martin's father was a Munkertaber too. Their job was strictly to go behind the lines, behind the front line, digging ditches, whatever the soldiers needed. My father was sent to, he was in Russia, with the Munkertaber. He was in Poland. When he came back in 1943, he said he witnessed by himself. They were digging ditches. They were digging the big ditches. They taught us for the front one day. And the next day, they came, when the ditches were finished, a day later or 2 days later, they were the same people, the same with the shovels came back. They had to cover up the ditches with human bodies. They were all Jewish people. And we didn't believe it. The only people didn't, the rabbi didn't believe it. How is it possible? Women and children and people just, for no reason at all. Today, you didn't dig ditches, and there must have been a reason why the people were killed. Couldn't believe it. He said, I don't know, that's it. We saw it ourselves. We didn't believe it.
How did that affect you and your father?
See, this is going back. I think different than I was 20 years ago. How can I expect my son to think like I do? I don't know how my father was thinking. I was thinking different to me. It was just, you know, I don't know. I didn't even know what to think about. That's why the older people, when I mean older, my father was 44 years old when he died. The reason I say older, I was only 16, naturally he was older. Just like we call him an old man here. That's why they couldn't survive. More younger people, younger you were, you had a better chance of surviving because your mind at least was only one concentrating on one thing, food. But their mind was concentrating on more different things. Food, their family, their wives, their children, their home, what is the future? So they couldn't think, they couldn't take everything at one time. Even now, if this would happen to me right now, my son has a better chance of surviving than I do. I'm gonna take a cigarette. You smoke?
No.
You don't mind if I smoke?
No.
Would you like a piece of candy? I'm not fancy. I'm not fancy, but I have a piece of candy. I told my wife not to go today. She said the only time she has a chance on Sunday. She works too, my wife. She wants to go with somebody to pick out at Hudson's. She went with somebody. Call her. I think my wife is coming up.
What are your hopes for your children, for their futures? Do you have any?
I hope they have a better future than I do. So far. My daughter is 22, my son is 24. So far, they have a better life than I had until I was their age. I had to struggle for everything I had, just for survival.
Is there anything else that you would like to to say before.
Like what? Okay, yeah, you ask me, so I'd be happy to.
Just anything that we haven't covered or anything else that you'd like to add?
Well, it happened, the worst thing was from 19. It was April 44 till May 1944, it was 13 months. If I want to write a book, everything that happened, it would take me 20 years. And it's still, in which even nobody will believe it in the future, really, what happened. Just like going back before, we do believe Jesus Christ was crucified. But nobody will believe what happened, even if we don't have no proof that Jesus Christ was crucified. The only thing we have is we don't have no pictures. All pictures are man-made. But it was no photograph. We do have photographs of what happened in Europe, but still we won't believe it. I mean, can you imagine, it was proof after the war by Russian doctors. It was proof. They opened up graves, pits, where the children were not even killed by bullets, just died from suffocation. Do you believe that? It happened. Those are facts, not fictions. I take one person to work. He's also Jewish. He was a Munkakaber, just like I said my father was. He was 100 miles on the other side of Kiev. You know that the Russians were there already, close to Moscow. The Germans were there already, close to Moscow. He said one day they went through the village, a normal peaceful village. That means already non-Jewish people. Jews were already cleaned out. There are few Jews, they survived, they ran away deeper to Russia. Jewish people who was left behind, when the Germans came in, they were automatically taken to Babi Yar. You heard of Babi Yar? Okay, I don't have to explain that. Then one day they came back, when they were retreating, the Germans, the Russians started going forward. The entire village, the non-Jewish population, entire village, houses and livestock were all leveled to the ground. For no reason at all. Those are facts, those are not fictions. In 1941 or 1942, I don't tell you exactly the year, you heard of Lidice?
Yes.
Yeah. You heard of Heydrich?
Yes.
Okay. He was the first one, he was a superior of Eichmann. Okay, you know that. I remember that I was a little child, that woman who lived in our house, her name was Haraksim, I have the address from her. She came in to my mother and she cried, she said, Heydrich was assassinated. There was two or three days before they leveled Lidice. She was crying. And my mother said, why do you cry? He's a German. You don't like the Germans either. He said, that bothers me very much because he's a big Nazi and they will take revenge. True enough, 3 days later, they leveled everybody alive to the ground. That was the first thing the Germans tried to prove to the world what they can do. After that was already a normal thing, day after day, different parts of the world. They did in France, Lyon, Europe, Lyon. Now they have in the headline, they're going to make a big fuss out of him. He should have been put to the crocodiles, and they should eat him alive, that big Nazi. Not to put him and give him doctor's attentions and big headlines. In on top of that, they're going to prove he's not healthy enough to stand trial. Is justice?
Because this can never be justice, and you know. Does she want to know what happened to you, Jake? Not what the.
In general, what happened to you?
Yeah. Because you know, this is.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you.